Good evening and welcome to Congressman John Sarbanes' live telephone town hall. In order for everyone to hear tonight's call, you are in listen-only mode. That means you can hear me and the congressman, but we can't hear you. If you'd like to ask a question on tonight's call, please press star 3 on your telephone keypad. Then you'll be transferred to a staff member who will take your name and your question. Again, if you'd like to ask a question on tonight's call, please press star 3 at any time, including now. I'll now turn it over to Congressman Sarbanes to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Dan. Welcome, everybody. This is Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing another in the series of telephone town halls that we've been doing over the last couple of months. Really, since the pandemic outbreak began, we've been trying to do these on a much more frequent basis. But, of course, I've had the privilege of doing these town halls for years now. It's a great way for me to connect with my constituents and hear directly from you, share what advice and guidance I can offer, let you know what's happening in Washington and in our politics, but most importantly, again, to get input directly from my constituents. If you want to ask a question tonight or you have a comment that you want to share, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll try to get to you as quickly as we can. We've got about an hour for this conversation. Again, star 3. Any question you want to ask tonight, any topic you want to touch on is certainly fair game. It's sort of open phones. Anything that you want to address, by all means, let us know. Again, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad if you have a question. Right now, you know what you want to talk about. Again, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad. We'll try to get to you as quickly as we can. I did want to make a few opening comments. Obviously, we continue to live in very, very challenging times and circumstances right now. We know that the pandemic has not let up. In fact, we see across the country that the number of infections is on the increase in many states, including some of our largest states like Florida and Texas and California. So we have to continue to take real precautions. In Maryland, we've done a pretty good job, I think, with those precautions and trying to get the infections down, the number of cases on a daily basis to get that reduced and reduce the number of people that are coming into the hospital for treatment. But we really can't let our guard down. And I certainly encourage people to continue to follow social distancing precautions where you can do that, to wear a mask when you're in public, to wash your hands carefully over the course of the day, and do the other things that the public health professionals are advising. I'm sure we'll have a chance to talk about some of that this evening. Again, if you want to ask a question on any topic tonight, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad. We'll try to get to you as soon as we can. Other topics that are very present in this moment. Obviously, coming off a number of weeks of protests around the killing of George Floyd, this tragic incident that occurred, which has really been a wake-up call for America and has led us to the moment we're in today. We will be voting later this evening on the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act of 2020, which is an effort to take a first meaningful step in addressing, unfortunately, the culture of racism and violence that we see in many institutions of law enforcement, including police departments across the country. And we know that we have to address that in a candid and honest way. And we believe that the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act, as I said, is a meaningful beginning. There's much more to accomplish, but if we can get that passed, I think we can begin to see some momentum to address these longstanding grievances and to try to bring some comfort to the families of those who've been victimized. So we can certainly talk about that whole challenge and what we're doing to address it. Again, if you're just joining me, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another of our telephone town halls, an opportunity for me to talk with you directly on issues of the day. If you have a question tonight, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you as quickly as we can. Again, star 3 on your telephone keypad if you'd like to ask a question or you just have a comment or would like to provide some input. I look forward to the conversation. So we've obviously got the situation of trying to address policing across this country. We continue to struggle to get past this pandemic, and we're going to have to pace ourselves there. The economic impact of the pandemic on our country cannot be overstated. We know it's severe. We know that there are millions of people who've lost their jobs. And while some are beginning to get back into the workplace, there are many who are not in a position to do that. And even those that are returning to the workplace need to have in place precautions and protections to make sure that they can carry out whatever their jobs are in a safe fashion. So this emphasis on testing, on providing protective equipment, personal protective equipment, even as we work to pursue treatments and ultimately a vaccine to address the COVID-19 virus. We've got many challenges in that respect, and I look forward to discussion on that this evening, both the health dimension and the economic dimension. So these are some of the topics that we're looking forward to talking about this evening on this call. If you'd like to ask a question, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad at any time, and we'll get you into the queue. Any topic is fair game this evening. I always try to do my best to answer these questions, but I'm also I've got a lot of humility, so if I can't answer the question, I'll certainly level with you on that. So again, if you want to ask a question, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you as soon as we can. Dan, why don't we get to our first caller if we've got one?
Our first caller tonight is Anne Marie from Silver Spring. Anne Marie, you're on the line.
Thank you. Congressman Sarbanes, thanks for making these town halls available. And I wanted to first thank you for your co-sponsorship of H.R. 6, House Resolution 6, the Dream and Promise Act, which provides a permanent solution for our DACA dreamers, brothers and sisters. I most appreciate that. I know McConnell is stopping it at the Senate. I appreciate your support. Thank you. My question is about the oversight of the stimulus packages, a package that has gone out. My understanding is there is no oversight. Is that accurate, and is there a way we can find out what's happening with a $1 trillion package?
That is a great question, and I think many share your concerns and anxieties that there's trillions of dollars of relief assistance going out to people across the country, and that we have to have transparency on how that money is being spent. We saw in the first round of the Paycheck Protection Program that some businesses that really weren't deserving of that support managed to grab hold of it, and I think that made a lot of people in the country angry. It certainly made me angry, and we need to have more transparency. There are some mechanisms in place. I'm pleased to let you know. First of all, there is a panel that's composed of inspector generals that has oversight on how these dollars are being spent. We put that into the CARES Act. Many of you remember that the CARES Act was this large stimulus and relief package that we passed some weeks ago to provide support for small businesses, direct payments to individuals and families across the country, extended and enhanced unemployment insurance benefits, and so forth. So significant dollars going out the door to try to help Americans in need, and we put in place some oversight mechanisms there, including that panel. We have also put in place oversight through a special committee, a select committee, subcommittee of the Oversight and Reform Committee that I sit on, and that subcommittee has the authority to dig down and figure out how these dollars have been spent across these various programs. This is modeled on something that Harry Truman did during the war to make sure that dollars were being spent in an effective and efficient way. So that's another mechanism we have. I can tell you that I have co-sponsored a bill that would insist on even more transparency, accountability, and particularly making sure that there's no sweetheart deals in there for people who have special influence, insiders who have conflicts of interest and can somehow grab these dollars, you know, off the top before they get out to the rest of the public. That's absolutely wrong, and it needs to be prohibited, and we're going to insist on that as we move forward. So I really appreciate the question about accountability because, as you know, I've tried for years to pass dramatic reform here to fight corruption and to insist on ethics, accountability, transparency, and serving the people's interests, not the special interests. It all goes hand in hand with what you're saying. So thank you for that question. Again, if you're just joining us, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another in the series of telephone town halls. We've done a number of these in the last few weeks on a more frequent basis than we typically do because we feel it's very important to stay connected to my constituents at this moment when there's so many challenges facing us, when I think it's important for you to hear from what hopefully you view as a trusted source of guidance and advice. And, of course, I benefit by having these because I can hear exactly what is coming at you and what your concerns are. So if you have a question tonight or a comment on any topic, again, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you hopefully before the hour is up. Dan, do we have any? Do we have a next caller?
Our next caller is Audrey from Towson. Audrey, you're on the line.
Hello? Might have lost Audrey. Are you there, Audrey? Hey, Dan, we may need to go to another.
We'll go next to Chip from Clarksville. Chip, you're on the line.
And I appreciate you doing these town halls. My question, among all the very serious matters we have to consider these days, the Department of Justice seems to have become President Trump's personal legal firm. He has they've dropped the case against General Flynn. It is apparent that they've meddled in the Roger Stone case. And there's a litany of things going on a daily basis at the Department of Justice that, you know, is very concerning to me. And I'm curious to find out what the House is planning to do differently to be able to rein this kind of thing in. We have not been able to do any oversight whatsoever of the executive branch. And maybe it's time to start doing something to bring the people you've subpoenaed to heel.
I appreciate that, Chip. I do think that the House of Representatives, where Democrats hold the gavel, is trying to exercise the oversight that you indicated. For example, when it comes to the Justice Department, the Judiciary Committee has been very aggressive in pressing the case when they see that the Justice Department is not doing what its mission is, which is to protect justice in this country and to make sure that nobody is above the law. Now, the problem, obviously, is we have an attorney general who, as you say, seems more interested in protecting the president and acting as the president's personal attorney, when in fact his responsibility should be to represent the people of of the United States when it comes to matters of law and justice. The Judiciary Committee, I know, in the next couple weeks is going to be having a hearing where they're going to hear from what equate to whistleblowers from within the Justice Department who are aggrieved by the way this situation up in New York has been handled with the removal of the attorney that was looking at the Stone case and some other cases up there and looking into other issues involving President Trump, because that kind of interference by the Justice Department in cases where we ought to see justice done is obviously beyond the bounds. So I think that both through the Oversight Committee, which I serve on, the Judiciary Committee, we're going to continue to press hard on the administration. But of course, it has to be said that the people have a role to play as well. And we are now a little over 4 months out from what many view as the most important election we've seen in recent history. So people are going to have the opportunity to register their own verdict on whether this president or this Justice Department or this Attorney General is behaving in a way that deserves to be reinforced or deserves to be changed. And that's what elections are for. So I'm very frustrated, as you are, by the way this Justice Department is behaving, even when it comes to prosecuting issues we've seen with how some of the elections are happening around the country with voter suppression. They've taken a kind of hands-off approach to that. So we have to be vigilant. We need a Justice Department that returns to its original mission of protecting the American people's interests and not just looking out for the President of the United States. So it's a very good and important question, and I appreciate your joining us tonight on the Town Hall. Again, if you're just getting on the call, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing another in our series of telephone town halls. It's open phones tonight. Any topic you want to talk about, press star 3 on your telephone keypad. If you would like to receive the Sarbanes Standard, which is our electronic newsletter, you can press 5 on your keypad, and we'll make sure we get you signed up for that. And if you have a particular issue or challenge you're facing with a federal agency where we could be of assistance, you can call my office during daytime hours at 410-832-8890. I do want to mention that next week we will be bringing to the floor here in the House of Representatives a major infrastructure bill. I know this is something many people in my district and across the country have been interested in for years. And we're finally going to start moving on that. Hopefully we can get some collaboration from Mitch McConnell on the Senate side and from the President. But we decided that we needed to push ahead with that. And that's what the Moving Forward Act is all about, as we've named it. It would make tremendous investments in our nation's infrastructure. And happy to talk about that more on this call. Why don't we get to our next caller, Dan?
Our next caller tonight is Miss Lee from Baltimore County. Miss Lee, you're on the line.
Thank you. I would like to thank Congressman for working so hard for the residents of Maryland State. And thank you for the opportunity to join this town hall meeting. So my question today is about unemployment. And I think you're probably aware of, you know, it was on the news, even local news, several times about people who've been furloughed have a hard time to get money from the Labor Department of Maryland. And one of my friends did not get her unemployment payment until 2.5 months later. And I don't think it's acceptable because people have bills to pay. And ended up, I know some of my friends have to take out their retirement funds. So I tried to find out, is anything to be done after, you know, the news, review this problem with the unemployment? If there is anything, can you give me some updates about
yes.
the unemployment? Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much for your call. I'm sure we have a lot of people joining us this evening who've been frustrated with the unemployment insurance benefit situation in the state of Maryland. Not unlike challenges we've seen across the country, this is what happens when we try to get a lot of assistance out using existing mechanisms for doing it that aren't used to processing so many claims. So it did lead to a backup at the State Department of Labor. We in the federal delegation were very concerned about this. I joined a letter that we sent to Governor Hogan asking for some explanation of why there were delays at the Department of Labor, and we've asked for information about that. My understanding is they are working to try to reduce the backlog, but there are still thousands of people, like your friend, who have not been able to get their claims processed. There are others who had to wait weeks and weeks before the first check came, and that put them in a very, very difficult situation. So I know the pressure that people are under who've lost their jobs and really are relying on these unemployment benefits to help carry them through from one week to the next, that puts people in a very, very difficult situation. We're getting a lot of questions and calls about that in our office, and we've been relaying those to the state authorities and asking for them to give close attention to processing these claims, and we will continue to do that. So it's a very fair question, and your frustration, and those of you who share that frustration about not getting those benefits as timely as you should, I certainly recognize that. We're going to continue to work as hard as we can to make sure that your concerns are addressed when it comes to the unemployment insurance benefits. I will also say that in the next round of assistance that we are trying to get passed here in Washington, we're calling it the HEROES Act, we would like to further extend unemployment insurance benefits because we know that there are millions of people across the country who will not be back at work in the near future, and they need that support and those resources. I'll continue to fight as hard as I can to get that extra resources coming from the federal government, and I'll also insist that the state of Maryland does its best to process those claims. So thank you for your question, because I know it's something that many on this call probably have similar concerns about. Again, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing one of our telephone town halls. Opportunity for me to hear directly from you, my constituents in the 3rd District, at what is a very, very challenging time for our country, whether it's the pandemic we're navigating, whether it's the economic impact that we've seen from that, which has really put tremendous stress on people, whether it's our efforts now to finally begin addressing systemic racism and a culture of violence that has infected many institutions across our country, including law enforcement organizations and police departments, and prosecutors' offices for that matter. We've got to take meaningful steps to address that. We're going to be voting this evening on the Justice and Policing Act of 2020, which we named after George Floyd, who was killed so tragically just in recent weeks, and rightly launched the protests across the country that we've seen demanding change. So please press *3 on your telephone keypad if you'd like to ask a question tonight, and we'll get to our next caller.
Our next caller this evening is Mary from Baltimore City. Mary, you're on the line.
Hi, my name is Mary Patterson, and I was hoping to get some questions answered about the visitation restrictions, you know, with regards to the COVID-19 pandemic. I have family members who are currently hospitalized, and they need support, family support. I'm just wondering when we might expect some lifts with those bans and those prohibitions and those no-nos.
Well, Mary, thanks for your question. It's been very tough on families who have not been able to visit loved ones, whether that means visiting them in the hospital because they're in the hospital getting treatment for some other issue, health challenge that they have, or whether, for example, it's visiting with people in nursing homes and senior facilities where there's been, you know, a policy over the last few months of trying to reduce that contact from the outside. I actually have relatives who are in nursing homes in Maryland, so I've directly experienced this loss of contact with them because of the restrictions, so I can certainly empathize with that. The place for you to go to get information about the current status of Maryland guidelines when it comes to visitation would be the Maryland State Department of Health. That's where Governor Hogan is administering the health guidelines and also directing the reopening of our economy, workplaces, businesses, and so forth. You can come to my website, which is sarbanes.house.gov. We've assembled, I think, a very good list of resources and guidance there, and we have links to all the appropriate authorities that can give you that kind of guidance. I encourage people on the call, please do that, because we worked hard to make sure we got good information posted there and we could direct you to the right place. There's no downside to consistently checking in with these sources of authority, whether it's the Maryland Department of Health or it's some of the websites that we've gathered up, and doing that on a frequent basis, because it is confusing for people. I understand that. And we also have the fact that Maryland State has certain guidelines, but depending on what county you live in, or whether in your case, Mary, where you live in Baltimore City, the guidance there may be slightly different. And what goes in the city or in the jurisdiction, the local jurisdiction, is typically what you should follow. So I encourage you to go to the state health department, go to the Baltimore City Health Department site, since that's where you live, and others on this call, reach out and get information from your local jurisdiction, whether it has to do with visiting relatives in the hospital or in nursing homes, or whether it has to do with what businesses are allowed to open and what precautions they need to take. While I have the chance, I will just emphasize again, as I've already done a few times on this call, please, if you can, continue to social distance. When you're out in public, please wear a mask. This is not just for your own protection, but for the protection of others, because a lot of times people don't have symptoms even though they're carrying the virus, and wearing a mask is a way to make sure that the people around you are not being infected if you happen to have the virus yourself. Continue to wash your hands on a regular basis and just exercise basic precautions. That's how we're going to get to the other side of this challenge, even as we are looking for treatments and ultimately finding a vaccine that can be used to combat the COVID-19 virus. So this challenge is with us for the foreseeable future, and we've got to work together and help each other through and make sure that we're looking at the guidance of health professionals, public health professionals, who have their fingers on the pulse of this outbreak. Again, if you're just joining us, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing a telephone town hall tonight, as I love to do, and we've been trying to do them every 2 or 3 weeks over the last couple of months, just because we know that at this moment it's important for us to stay in regular conversation with people in my district. I learn a tremendous amount by hosting these calls. I hope you learn something as well and benefit from the conversation that we have. Let's get to our next caller, Dan.
Our next caller is Eileen from Baltimore. Eileen, you're on the line.
Hi, Congressman Sarbanes. Thank you for this and all the work that you do. My original interest was in H.R. 1, and I really appreciate all the work that you did on that. But my concern listening to you is all of your good intentions and hard work are being stonewalled in the Senate. And realistically speaking, I'm very concerned about election security. It feels like nothing's really going to happen with all of this hard work as long as it gets stonewalled in the Senate. And so the elections are our only hope. And I'm wondering if you could help me to understand the status of your efforts to ensure election security and other items that are in the H.R. 1 Act.
Well, thanks, Eileen. I appreciate your giving a shout out to H.R. 1, the For the People Act. This is the bill that I was privileged to assemble as the first bill that we introduced in the 116th Congress last January after Democrats took back the gavel. And as you know, it's an effort to really address the corruption that people are so angry about in our politics and fix our democracy in meaningful ways. Increasing ethics and accountability, making it easier, not harder, for people to register and vote, fixing partisan gerrymandering across the country, and then for sure fighting back against the undue influence that big money and special interests have over the way our priorities get determined in Washington. Big money just has too much influence, and people are sick of that. And they want to know that the people they send to Washington are going to fight against that and represent the interests of everyday Americans. So I'm going to continue that fight. You're right that included in those reforms are things designed to protect our democracy against foreign interference, to preserve election security, to make sure that we can have elections where we have confidence that people can vote, that their vote will be tallied accurately, and that our democracy can be strong. And we included in the first CARES bill, there was $400 million to go out to states across the country, including the state of Maryland, which got about $7 million, to help with election security and other measures to prepare for November and for the primary, frankly, that we just went through. We're trying to get additional dollars in the HEROES Act, which is this next big bill to provide relief and assistance to the country in the midst of the pandemic, because we know that local and state election officials around the country, they need resources. They need resources to help with the vote-by-mail option that we want to give to people. They need resources to cover polling places in the midst of the pandemic, make sure that protective equipment is there because there are some people that still need to vote in person. So we're going to continue to press for those dollars. I was part of an effort on the that our delegation put together in the last couple weeks to raise some of the issues that came up in the Maryland primary because there were challenges there. And to say, here are some of the things we got to fix before we get to the November election. I was pleased to see that the presiding officers in the General Assembly in the last couple days released their sort of advice and guidance on how we should do our election this fall in Maryland, which is basically a hybrid of in-person voting and vote by mail, as well as more early voting opportunities. So we're going to continue to push for that. The Department of Homeland Security is the place where the alerts are shared with states when Homeland Security gets information that some foreign actors might be trying to interfere in our elections and hack into our elections. So we're also going to press on the Department of Homeland Security to make sure that they are carrying out that mission to protect our democracy. This is who we are. American democracy is the most treasured asset that we carry with us as Americans, and we have to protect it and keep it resilient. Everyone in America, I don't care whether you're a Democrat or Republican, independent, you want to have faith and confidence that you can cast your vote and that your vote will be counted. And we got to do everything we can between now and November to ensure that that expectation is met. So I really appreciate you bringing up that topic because it's the most fundamental thing, really, in our democracy. Again, if you're just joining us, it's Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing another in our series of telephone town halls, opportunity for me to talk directly with people in my district to get a sense of the challenges you see, answer your questions where I can. If you'd like to ask a question tonight, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get to you as quickly as we can. If you have a particular issue that you need help from someone on my staff, you can call during daytime hours, 410-832-8890. Of course, you can always go to my website at sarbanes.house.gov. We've assembled a lot of good information there, by the way, related to the COVID-19 pandemic, places you can go to get guidance, and other resources, so I encourage people to use that. Again, you can go to sarbanes.house.gov. Dan, let's get to the next caller.
Our next caller is Suzanne from Baltimore. Suzanne, you're on the line.
Hi, thank you, Congressman Sarbanes, for everything that you're doing. My big concern is regarding law enforcement and what are we doing about improving systems with either social workers or therapists to get those people into the right areas so that we can stop killing people?
Well, thanks, Suzanne. I appreciate the question. One of the main topics of conversation right now is how do we start redesigning public safety and our approach to public safety in this country? Because the fact of the matter is that billions of dollars flow every year at the state and local level, with some grant money also coming from the federal level to police departments across the country. But some of those dollars, can be repurposed to get to social workers, to get to organizations that work to build community within our cities and other places, for example, where the result would be safer neighborhoods, stronger communities, a better quality of life, because you're being more innovative and more, I guess, responsive to the real needs of the community. So I'm excited about that. I'm excited about places like Baltimore being able to be a model of how you can reimagine public safety, particularly if you are connected to the community and you build that conversation. In the wake of the Freddie Gray case, as you know, Baltimore has entered into a consent decree with the Justice Department, the Baltimore Police Department has, where there's certain significant reforms that have to be put in place. As part of that, there were established structures for direct input from the community, from the people out there who are affected by the way the police department operates. And those conversations are bringing forward these opportunities for real, meaningful reform, not just lip service, because we've seen that that can't do the job. We need real change in the way police departments and law enforcement operate, and then we need to put the funding behind those kinds of reforms to make sure that they stick. And this is the great challenge in this moment. I think that the legislation we will be passing later this evening, which is the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act of 2020, named for George Floyd, who was tragically and brutally killed just a few short weeks ago, that's a very good first step. That Justice in Policing Act, it's at the federal level, but it sets a standard. It creates some new expectations of how law enforcement should operate across this country and begin to address what has become, in many places, a culture of racism and brutality that we have to affix. So I'm going to continue to be pushing very, very hard at the federal level to set those new standards to meet the expectations of the protesters that we've seen around the country for real change. And then to work at the state and local level, to work with our colleagues in government, but most importantly, to work with members of the communities that are affected so that we can see the kind of reform that can really make a difference over time. Appreciate that question. Obviously, this is top of mind for many, many people in Maryland and across the country. Again, if you're just joining us, Congressman Sarbanes, we are doing another in our series of telephone town halls. If you would like to ask a question tonight, you can press *3. If you'd like to sign up for the Sarbanes Standard, which is our electronic newsletter, and we have thousands of people who receive that, you can go to my website and sign up there. That's sarbanes.house.gov, or you can just press 5 on your keypad this evening. We'll make sure we get you signed up for that. Dan, let's get to the next caller.
Our next caller tonight is Daniel from Towson. Daniel, you're on the line.
Hi, Congressman Sarbanes. my question is related to the COVID-19 response. And, you know, I think after some initial hiccups, our country has done very well regarding testing capabilities and distribution of PPE. But if you look at our country compared to some of the other countries that have really shut this thing down, I think the one thing that's really missing is very robust contact tracing and quarantines of people that have been exposed to somebody who tests positive. So I was wondering, you know, obviously we can't make measures as draconian as what happens in China with forced quarantines, but what kind of moves Congress can make to make more robust contact tracing and quarantining as part of our response.
Yeah, well, thanks, Daniel. Obviously, contact tracing is a critical component of the response to the pandemic. We talk about testing, obviously, being critical, then contact tracing, then isolation when people are identified as having the virus. There's so many different components that go into this, and we got a late start on it. There's no question about that. We've been playing catch-up really from late January, beginning of February until now, and I think that's why we've seen such high numbers of infections when you compare us, frankly, to any other country around the world. At the federal level, we have committed billions of dollars towards testing, contact tracing, but we've also insisted and asked that the Trump administration have a strategic plan in place, a national plan to respond to this. Yes, there's a clear role for states and localities to step up into this space and try to mount a meaningful response. But you need broad guidance and an overall framework and plan at the federal level, or else you get this needless competition and friction happening between states and between local governments that doesn't help the overall effort. So we've insisted, and we do this again in the HEROES Act, which we're trying to get passed out of Congress. We did pass it in the House, that the administration deploy a broad plan to guide testing, protective equipment, contact tracing. I will recognize that in the state of Maryland, there are efforts to stand up contact tracing at the state level, but also a number of jurisdictions have made that a real priority. So I am, and more people are being trained, you may know this, every day to do the contact tracing. So you're right, we don't operate the way the government of China or other places operate, where you just send out an order and lock everybody down. That's not how we conceive of things in this country. That's not consistent with our freedoms and civil liberties. But if we create the opportunity for people to participate in these options voluntarily, and if we demonstrate to them that it will lead to a positive result, not just for them as individuals, but in terms of our country being able to reopen and get back to some sense of normalcy, then I think people will respond to that. So I'm going to continue to work very hard to get that kind of framework in place. We certainly have put resources out there from the federal government to support that effort, and there needs to be that kind of overall collaboration and leadership from the administration, I think, working in tandem with states and local governments across the country. Again, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We're doing a telephone town hall. I think we'll probably have time for a few more questions before we have to close out, but let's get right to our next caller, Dan.
Our next caller tonight is Mala from Baltimore. Mala, you're on the line.
Yes, thank you so much, Representative Sarbanes, for doing this. A lot of people have raised questions I had questions about, too. So I'm wondering, though, as far as the effort in Congress around the police brutality against blacks and brown communities, what could get through both houses of Congress? I know that a recent bill failed. Was that on the Senate side, I guess? And I'm just wondering, is there any common ground? Can you all get something through both houses that Trump would sign? I mean, we've seen with gun violence, everything fails.
Yeah,
so horrific that this level of violence in our country, that Congress always falls apart.
Yeah. Well, I understand that frustration. I share it, frankly. We've passed a lot of things that I thought were really good legislation in the House, and Mitch McConnell has not wanted to pass those on the Senate side, beginning with H.R. 1, which was to fight corruption and fix our democracy, but continuing with things like addressing gun violence, trying to strengthen our health care system, reduce the cost of prescription drugs. All of these things came out of the House, and they're just sitting on the Senate side. When it comes to this effort to address injustice in policing across the country and put in place key reforms, the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act is something we think is real. And my concern is that the proposals on the Senate side so far, while they sound good, when you get into them, they don't really have the kind of teeth and enforcement in them as far as reform goes that would make a real difference. I think the public is ready to see something real. And we're going to pass this bill, I'm confident of that, later this evening. And it then becomes the standard for judging what is real and meaningful. And hopefully then the public will continue to put pressure so that the Senate will realize they've got to do some things that are more consequential than what they've offered up so far. It's also important, I think, in this moment that just the declaration that comes from the passage of this George Floyd Justice in Policing Act, the statement that we want to do things differently, that we're ready to, mandate the use of body and dashboard cameras among federal policing, to ban chokeholds and no-knock warrants, to end the transfer of military equipment that's meant for the battlefield but ends up in local police departments across the country, to take real steps, just collectively making that statement that we want to move to a new place in this country that really does begin to address racial discrimination, police brutality, and this legacy, that's a powerful thing in and of itself. And then I hope that with the outcry that we've seen over the last few weeks and continuing to bring that pressure, we actually can get something real passed here in Washington. But as I said in an email I sent, if our leaders don't share the vision of creating a fairer and more equitable and more just America, then we change our leaders. That's the opportunity we have in our country with the vote. And we have an election coming up in November that's very consequential. And whether you're a Democrat or Republican or independent, I urge you to participate fully in your democracy by getting out and voting this fall because there's never been a more important time to express what is the highest form of protest in a democracy, which is the right to vote. So thank you for that question. Dan, why don't we get to our next caller?
Our next caller is Michelle from Pikesville. Michelle, you're on the line.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sarbanes. My question relates to the pandemic response team that used to be part of the National Security Agency and was disbanded by Bolton and Trump as soon as they could get, when they disbanded everything. When Trump was asked a question by a journalist about this very panel, he said, oh, well, I didn't do it, but somebody did it, and so if they're gone, it's just because there were too many people, and we can always get them back. Well, if we can always get them back, my question is, what has been done and what can be done to find out who exactly these individual human beings were who were on that committee, where they are, what it takes to hire them back, demand that they be hired back, that the whole pandemic response team be reconstituted and made a very, very important part of our federal government immediately, because those human beings that were on that response team knew what to do, and they still probably know what to do, and we need it.
Well, Michelle, first of all, you're absolutely right. It was shameful to disband the pandemic response team under this administration, because then we were completely flat-footed when the pandemic hit. You didn't have already assembled, as you should have done, the team that could have immediately sprung into action. I have no confidence, I'm just going to be very candid with people on the call, I have no confidence that the president is going to that this president will reconstitute that team. I think a poor excuse for it has been the White House Coronavirus Task Force, which in my view has not really managed the situation in a way that inspires confidence. Certainly going forward, and this will probably have to happen under a new president, we need to reconstitute that pandemic response team and give them the charge that they have to make sure that we're ready for the next episode of this, that our stockpile is filled with up-to-the-date equipment, that the communication network with states and localities on how to respond as a public health matter to a pandemic is robust and ready to move quickly, that there's the coordination going on among all the federal agencies that have a role to play. It's not rocket science. It's challenging and it's difficult, but you can put together a framework that makes you ready for these outbreaks when they occur in a much better fashion than what we saw in the early days of this outbreak. So it's been very frustrating to me. We are, through our oversight committees, asking those tough questions and insisting that all the issues and challenges that need attention be focused on. But sadly, I think the fact that the president would allow that pandemic response team to be disbanded in the first place shows that the focus that needs to come from this administration just hasn't been there from the outset. So that's something that we have to remedy. Let's get to our next question, Dan.
Our next caller is Joe from Towson. Joe, you're on the line.
Hello, Congressman. I want to drill down a little bit on the election security issue. What is Congress doing to protect the public from the internet bots that post false stories on the web, as we saw in 2016?
Well, actually, I just sat on a panel yesterday. We had a hearing with some of these digital platforms being discussed. We brought in some experts to talk about the kind of thing you're mentioning, which is the amount of disinformation that can be generated on social media platforms. And my view is that those companies, those platforms like Facebook and Twitter and others need to take more responsibility for what happens on their platforms. And while we don't want them to censor things and any kind of egregious fashion, they should be on the outlook for stuff that is clearly false information and provide accurate information to people. When it comes to voting, I know that we're going to see in the last 6 weeks of this election a lot of disinformation coming at people. And it's going to be really, really important that that these digital platforms police that activity and try to correct it and make sure that people have good information when it comes time to go vote. As I've said many times on this call and many times generally, there's never been a more important election than the one that's coming at us in November. I encourage everybody on this call to get good information, find that trusted source that you are comfortable relying on when it comes to information about the election, when you're going to be able to vote, where you're going to be able to vote, how to do vote by mail, because there'll be a lot of bad information circulating. And I'm going to do my best to be a source of good information on that, so please continue to reach out to us, go to my website. I also encourage you to do that around the census. We're trying to get the 2020 census completed. I'll ask you as we close the call here tonight, please, if you have not filled out your census form yet or completed it online or by phone, please do that. It's important that everybody is counted. That's another critical part of what makes our democracy strong, is getting an accurate census every 10 years. So we are in 2020, and in this year, we have two amazing opportunities to exercise two of the most important things in our democracy. One is to be counted through the census, and the other is to be counted through our vote. And I encourage all of you to participate. Again, regardless of party, regardless of views, regardless of the issues that motivate you, the thing that should motivate all of us is to get out, cast our vote, be heard, register in the census, and make sure that we are counted in our democracy. I want to thank everybody for joining this evening. As I said at the outset, I enjoy doing these telephone town halls because it's my chance to hear directly from you and have a conversation. That can be hard to come by these days when it's all kind of online. Social media and virtual stuff, but to be able to talk directly to people really helps me do my job better, and I hope it's something that's valued by my constituents. We'll certainly continue to do it. We're going to have to close the call, but if you have a particular issue you need help with, by all means, you can call my office during daytime hours at 410-832-8890. If you want to go to my website, it's sarbanes.house.gov. There's a lot of good information collected there, particularly as relates to the pandemic, the health precautions that we need to take, the resources available to help people in these tough economic times, and, of course, information on the bills that we are passing here in Washington this evening. I expect us to pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, which is a very important first step in addressing these challenges across the country that we see with racism and violence in so many of the institutions of law enforcement. So we need to start there and begin to build from it. Again, thank you for joining us. I look forward to having you be part of our next telephone town hall. Be safe. Take care. And look forward to talking with you again soon. Good night.